there is also a problem if you are using too many variables, and especially when you have very few points. When you use too many variables, it produces an effect of overfitting. Your maps result like very, very tight, and they don't represent the world distribution of the species. Here we use 19 variables for these very few points, and here we use only 9. You see? Normally, overdimensionality is a problem because of the effect of overfitting, but also because as if you increase the number of variables, you also increase the correlation among these variables. And having this correlation in the variables, specifically or particularly for statistical modeling methods, have consequences. And it's a good practice, it's convenient before running a model to do an analysis on the behavior of the variables to see how strongly they are correlated. If you find strong correlation among several of the variables, it is convenient to remove some of them to reduce the dimensionality of your data set. Also, you can use multivariate statistical techniques for reducing the dimensionality of the environmental data set, like principal component analysis, and using the principal components as the predictors. Well, these are more, these were more the conceptual issues regarding the environmental variables related to the niche of the species. Do you have any question up here? Yes?
Yeah, thank you very much for the presentation. I have tried to predict especially future scenarios, but if you use more variables in the future scenarios, you, for example, I was trying to do this with fruit flies. You get a picture that shows like almost the whole niche will disappear. But when you go on reducing some of these variables, then you get some of that niche being seen. Then the other thing about the correlation, most of these variables, especially the climatic variables, are highly correlated. So you struggle to reduce the amount of linearity because most of them go up to about 0.9. And yet, in the interpretation of the results, sometimes some of these variables are very meaningful. It's very easy to tell someone about rainfall variation than, say, isothermality. So it is so correlated, but it makes meaning in the interpretation. I don't know how you go about that.
Thank you. That's also a good question. It is true when you have too many variables, what you do is you increase the complexity of the model. And think of this like that. If you have too many variables, you will have almost infinite number of combinations of environmental conditions in each one of the pieces. So when you project to a different scenario, it's very difficult to find such combinations. So that's why you see that your solution disappears. But here you have the problem of collinearity of the variables. So you need to reduce the number of variables. And if you have two variables that have biological meaning, but they are strongly autocorrelated, what's the problem of including one? If they are giving you almost the same information for the model, just take one.
So when you are saying that using too many variables will lead to, I mean, the correlation between them, and we have to select the variables which are not correlated, if not we are, I mean, replicating the same information. I would like to know from which number of variables can we consider that there are too many. which number of variables we can consider for important?
What number?
Yes.
What number of variables can we consider that is, you say it's good, but there is not an answer for that. It depends on the species. For some species that have very narrow fundamental niches, it would be very few variables. But there are some species that have very broad niches and very broad tolerance, physiological tolerances to all these variables. They have larger number of variables. So there is not a direct question or a universal answer for the question of how many. The way we do it is testing. All the time we are testing. What happens if we remove the correlated variables, how does the model behave? It's more trial and error. But it's important that you use your biological knowledge of the species to make these decisions. Yes?
Yeah.
Thank you. I would like to comment on what you just said now. I also believe when you are looking at the effect, it also depends on the resolution. Because if I recall one of the slides, you see at high resolution, we can use climate parameter to do our prediction. And you see, as the resolution goes down, you include some biotic factor. You even talk about some soil irradiation. Remember what that means? One important thing depends on what you are really trying to see. If you are trying to predict the distribution just in the mountain or within a valley, you may try to capture as many parameters as possible because the resolution is low and the parameter that allow the species, also the interaction, the predator and all these things. If you are not incorporating them, you may not have.
If we do, we didn't have, frequently we didn't have that information at hand. So we need to use different variables. Again, to test it with different combinations of variables to see which one is giving the best results. Do you have any comments? You want comments? Okay, let's continue. Any other questions about these conceptual considerations? Let's go to the practicalities of this.
Hold up one second. Don't get caught up on everything. Going into many levels.
There are several aspects that we need to take into account when manipulating environmental variables. They are the geographic coordinate systems, of which I mentioned, the format, the source, the quality, the spatial resolution, the temporal resolution. If we are transferring models, projecting our models to different scenarios, we need to have considerations on that alternative scenario. And the type and units of measure. Let's see which one of these. It is mandatory that all our information is in the same geographic coordinate system, using the same projection, using the same date, etc. Richard mentioned, I'm not going to go more on this, but Richard already said that. But both your biological information and your geographical information have to be the same system. Any of all the methods that we will be working with can handle different projection systems. If you have your information in UTMs, your maps, and your coordinates in UTMs, you can use them as they are. Most of the information out there that we can gather from the internet comes in geographic coordinate system, and it is frequent that we need to convert our information to match the information of the environmental layer structure. How many of you know what is the vector of the raster models in the GIS representing of the maps? Okay, for those that do not know, when you are using the GIS, or the maps that you use in the GIS can have different formats. The most common ones are these two, the vector model and the raster model. And it's a different way of representing the elements of the landscape. The vector model uses points, lines, and polygons to represent all the features on the surface of the Earth. Whereas the raster model represents these elements by pixels, and each one of these cells, this pixel, contains a piece of information that tells you the value of that variable that you are representing. In each modeling, we always need to use this raster format. So if you have a very a variable that you need to use in your modeling process in a vector format, you need to convert it from vector to raster, which in GIS is a simple process. But it's important for you to know that all the information has to be in this format. It's important to know, as Richard mentioned, the origin of your information, the source of your information, because that's the way you can have elements to decide if that information is useful or not for your particular interest. Geographic information generally comes from two different sources. Raster maps are constructed from two different sources, from interpolated data and from remote sensing. interpolation, interpolated data means that you have points in a region like this one, and from the points you feel the surface covering the whole region. There are statistical techniques that allows you to estimate the values in the empty cells. This is called interpolation, an interpolation process. For example, if we have a map representing some climatic variable, precipitation in a region, let's say in the whole continent of Africa, this was derived from climatic stations that are located at specific sites across the whole continent. Then we use this point data to create the surface. One of the most popular and widely used source of information, source of climatic information for building ecological niche models is this WorldClim data set or database. Here is the link to the web page. This data set contains 19 variables that represent like the annual and extreme and seasonal behavior of temperature and precipitation represented in these 19 variables for the whole world at different resolutions or spatial scales. The finest one is 1 kilometer resolution. That means that each pixel measures 1 by 1 kilometer. The quality of the information, of the interpolated information, is given by the density of the points that you have in that region. For example, here we have two different sources of data. This is the WorldClim dataset that I just showed you, and this is